If you are ready to lean into the power of AI, look no further than this video. I'm going to be showing you how to build your own automation using AI and Airtable. Airtable is going to store our data, and we're going to have the ability to send messages to ChatGPT that have context through the automation that we are building here in this video. So if learning more about building contextual automation with AI is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth and this is Gap Consulting. It's my mission here to help you get the full potential of your no-code tools and some of our favorite no-code tools we are using in this video. I'm talking about Airtable and Zapier, and of course, we are including ChatGPT as well. Now, I know that there are going to be a lot of questions about why we did it this way, how we did it. There's a ton of stuff to cover in this video. But before we get into the heart of it, I first want to invite you to join me for some templates. If you're kind of new to Airtable, maybe you haven't built a lot in no code, these templates are going to get you up and running quickly. And most importantly, we are going to accompany each template with a short video allowing you to get the full potential out of it, so that you can really maximize and improve your workflows. And these templates were built for the 5 most common use cases that we consult with day in and day out in our company. Grab those templates for free, gapconsulting.io/templates. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen. We were gonna get started here. Now, first, this is my form. This is how we are going to take in new inquiries. Now, I built this form in Airtable. We could use a more advanced form software. That's entirely up to you if you choose to do so. Now, of course, that will add a lot more complexity that I didn't want to get into here. So I used the native Airtable form, and you'll see there's just 3 simple fields for it. It's the name, it's the email, and it's a message. So what is it that this person is inquiring about? And we're going to go ahead and open up this form as well so that I can actually use it once we are ready to test out our system. But let's first go into our actual database. It's really quite simple what I've built here for this example. So let's break it down step by step, and I'll tell you why I have each piece. So number one, we have the date a message is received. This is our primary field, and you can see that I am including time and the time zone, and I set a default so that when we get a new record, it's gonna automatically get timestamped with the time that the record came into existence, basically. Now we have your name. This is one of the fields on our form. We wanna know who is submitting the inquiry. But most importantly, we wanna know their email address. So I've got another field here, your email. So these 2 fields were both included on that form that you just saw. And then we also have the customer message. This is what the customer is telling us, and they can access that form in a number of ways. Maybe we've put a link for that form in our email correspondence. Maybe we have it embedded on our website. So however the customer is engaging with our brand, they can just boom right there, communicate in that form, submit it, and we're gonna collect a log of their request or their inquiry. And that goes in the customer message. So these were the 3 required fields: your name, your email, customer message. These are the required fields in our form. Now we're gonna go over to some of the other stuff. Now we wanna create a message ourselves. And it's one thing to create a message response to the message that we received, right? But the issue here is that we want to create a message in context of the thread that we have with this customer. So if this customer has sent us a lot of messages over the last few days, as in our example, well then we want to make sure that we're replying in context to those messages. So let's take a quick look at this example that I built up. So you can see on March 6th, the customer message was, "I need help canceling my subscription." Okay. It happens. So the reply message that we generated at that time, and this is a fake reply message, was, "Sure, here's the link, example.com. Cool. Then 2 days later, the customer reaches out again and says, "Hey, I got another thing to say here, another inquiry. I canceled, but I wasn't refunded yet." All right. So what do we reply? Well, we have another reply message in the context of this entire interaction. The reply message is, "Hey, refunds can take 3 to 5 days. So, like, you know, hang on, it's coming." So that's the idea here, that we've got a thread of conversation that's happening. And each time we automate this particular process with ChatGPT, we want to send all of the context of that message over when we create our new reply message. Because if we just tell the customer again, yeah, here's the link to cancel, they're going to get a little upset, right? Because obviously we have no context to the overall conversation. So that's what we're working on building here. And that is the first key point as to why I'm not using Airtable's AI in this particular example. Airtable's AI is great, but it only gets the context existing in that record. And so I want to actually send the full context of multiple records over a conversation with a customer over to ChatGPT. That's why we are going to be leveraging outside AI assistance here. Now, I also have the format here, and this is my formula that is stringing together a lot of stuff. It's a concatenate, which is basically meaning we're tagging a lot of stuff together and stringing it into one big output. And I'm using this because I want to have this in my prompt to GPT. So basically, I'm stringing together the message received date, including the not only the day, but the hour and time that it was received. And then the customer message, and then the support message. So the output is really a combination of a lot of the information in each record. So I'm saying, hey, look, on March 8th at 800 Greenwich Mean Time, customer said, I canceled, but I wasn't refunded. Support replied, refunds take 3 to 5 days. I'm going to send that little snip of text into my ChatGPT prompt. So now that we understand the basic structure, we want to build that automation. Now, I've already built it, but we're going to go through step by step as to what I built and why. And then finally, we're going to test it and discuss some of the pitfalls about using this type of approach. So let's dive into the automation. I will be using Zapier, a third-party automation tool, to communicate with ChatGPT. So there are 5 steps in this particular automation. The first one is the trigger, and we're saying, hey, we received a new record in our setup here. So the way we set this up is we say, you know, point the automation to the base, which we've called customer support log. We look at the table, and we're just saying any new record that comes into existence here, we want to trigger the automation based on that. So that's the event type here. So on the setup, we're saying choose the event type of a new record, and then we tell it what particular base and table we are watching. Next, let's move on to step 2, where we are going to make sure that we format our email to be lowercase. Now, this isn't going to come into play again until the final step in our automation when we update the record, but here's the deal. Sometimes people will type in an email address and use capital letters. And if we are going to search based on the context of the relationship or the conversation that we've had, we need something to look up and match against. So we are looking up the conversation that's been held with this email address. And if this email address is not consistent every time it's in our system, then it might cause some problems. So when we go to update the record at the final step, we're going to ensure that we update it with that lowercase version. We are going to fully lowercase it. In order to do that, and by the way, this doesn't cost or require any Zapier cost on your end. We're simply going to go and use the formatter by Zapier. It's a text event, and we use the lowercase transformation. So any capital letters that were in this email address will be removed when we go through this step. Next, the important step of finding the contextual messages that already exist in our Airtable database. So let's look at how we set this whole thing up here. We'll go into the first part for setup, and we're again looking at Airtable, and we're choosing the event of finding many records. Now, this is a relatively newer event type that we did not always have access to in Zapier, so it's a slightly more advanced one, but let's go through the configuration. So we again map it to our base. This is pretty standard. And we map it to our table. And we're looking for the email field. And what we want to search for is the lowercase version of the email that we received in our new record. So again, we are going to be updating the email to make sure that it's always lowercase at the final step of our automation, which means that all previous conversations that we've had with this particular individual, assuming they came from the same email address, they are already going to be lowercased. So we need to search for the exact output here, the lowercased version of the email from the previous step. Now I need to also highlight that we are limiting this to a view called completed replies. And this is a really important step as well. If we flip back into our database, you'll see I've created a view here, completed replies, and it is doing two things. Number one, filtering out messages that do not have a reply message. So if we don't have any information in the replied field, it's going to filter it out. We only want to include, in terms of context in our ChatGPT prompt, conversations that have already happened. And if there are none, then of course we don't want to bring them in here. So we're filtering out all conversations that are not yet completed, that we have not replied to. And then the other very important thing is that we are sorting this and we're putting the earliest messages on the top. That way when we have the context with ChatGPT and we say, hey, here are the previous messages, we're going to start by the oldest message and then go through historically chronological order. So that is very important in terms of setting up this view. And then we want to limit the search, the find record search, to that view. So again, we are searching based on email. So we will only find conversation that relates to this particular individual's conversation. And we want to only look at the completed replies in particular order. Then, my friends, it's time to build the prompt. This is the part we've all been waiting for. And here's what the prompt looks like. We simply say, you are an AI support assistant for example company. Here's a conversation history. And then all we're bringing in here is that formula field that we built. If you recall back in Airtable, this little important formula has the entire conversation snip, including the date, time that the conversation happened, what the customer said, and what our reply to the customer was. So we are putting all of that in the prompt to ChatGPT. And because we can find more records than just one, I mean, we might find zero, we might find 10. Well, whatever we find, it's going to all be listed out here. Then we're saying, hey, here's the new inquiry. We just got this from step one, and the step one was the new record. So a new customer message came in, and then we say, hey, based on this history, please generate a professional and empathic response. Just return a response without a greeting or signature. So I've kind of played with this a couple times already and found ChatGPT to say things like, hi, customer, or, you know, this was an AI response or something like that. We just want to bring the response and plug it back into Airtable. You can tweak all of this, the temperature, the maximum length, etc. Also, please note that in our setup, we have chosen to send a prompt. From here, we're going to go to update the record. So whatever we get out of ChatGPT, we're going to update that in our reply message. And then lastly, we're going to make sure that we update the email address. Remember, that was a key component for the whole searching capability. So we are updating the email address that is purely lowercased, and we are updating the response that came from ChatGPT. And then imagine what this looks like. We get that response, it automatically goes back into Airtable, and our customer support team does not have to draft that message. All they have to do now is approve it. So they can have a quick little interface that sees a new message come in from a customer, an automated AI-generated message that's created by ChatGPT, and all that our team needs to do is click on something that says message approved, or maybe they go in and tweak a few words here and there, then approve the message. That can trigger another email to reply to the customer. Now, typically, I don't recommend that we have ChatGPT interact directly with the customer. I do want there to be a little bit of a buffer, and that is why we're building this and storing it back in Airtable so that our customer support team can approve the message before actually submitting it. But now, one customer support agent can do as much work as five because they're not manually drafting all of these messages. They're simply approving them to be sent out. So let's take a look at this thing in action. Let's go to our form, actually, and I'll flip over to all messages here for a moment. All messages is not the same view as completed replies. So when we submit the new message, we will see it added here, and then we can watch as the automation takes shape. So I'll fill out my name. And of course, I want to use my actual email address. And the reason for this is I've already used it here on previous emails in the thread. So that way, when we perform the search, it will find my previous emails. And now back to the form, I will say, hey, I still haven't received my refund. And let's submit. And so let's go back here. So let's track this. We just see that the new record was created. There's not yet a reply message, but let's talk about the history. The person reached out, needed help canceling. ChatGPT said, yeah, here's the link. Then they said, I canceled, but I wasn't refunded. And then we said, hey, refunds can take 3 to 5 days. Then over here, we have their new message that says, hey, I still haven't received my refund. And now you can see that ChatGPT just created a response and brought it back for us. So here's the response. I apologize for the inconvenience. Refunds typically take 3 to 5 business days to process. If you have not received your refund after this time frame, please let us know. So here's the important thing. The messages started on 3/6. 3 to 5 business days is still, we're still within that window. ChatGPT knows all of that and yet drafted an empathic response, taking full context of the thread and being able to bring it in right here. How awesome is that? The whole thing was automated for us. All we have to do now is approve this message or make small tweaks like I was doing here. I do apologize for the inconvenience. Like maybe we want to add a little bit of extra flavor. Maybe I don't want these quotation marks in here, but it's pretty simple to build an automation that now sends this as a reply to the client or customer once we've approved it internally. I know we went really fast in this video, but there is a lot to cover. But I hope that you see how powerful the ultimate integration of ChatGPT and Airtable can truly be. If you have questions that we did not get to in this video, please swing by our website. We have a ton of resources available for you, including some paid services that you might want to take advantage of. Of course, we would love it if you did get value. Give us that thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. But most importantly, keep on building.